Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Now, feel free to get in touch with us on our socials. Tell us what you think about the show. Plus, also, we're headed into Christmas. What are some of the things you're doing? Let us know. And if you have any challenges as a business person and there are things you need addressed, maybe on how to handle particular things, we can have the experts here to talk to you about them. And that should help you to end the year in style. Like we keep saying, in business, there's always an opportunity. So if you probably started the year on a sad note, it doesn't mean you could end it on the same. You could actually turn things around somehow and make this happen. So just feel free to get in touch with us and we'll be more than glad to get back to you. All right, let's talk how to make money.
My name is Godfrey Akabura. I work with Nagric and DB, and I'm stationed in Entebbe. Under beef, there are many breeds of beef cattle, all over the world. Starting from maybe the Boran, which are here in East Africa, especially Kenya and Uganda. We've got the Brahman, we've got the Ramanura, we've got what we call the Charolais. There are many. Here at our store, at the beef store, we only have the Boran, which are here in Uganda, and they are under management of Nagric, which is the body which is in charge of livestock breeding, improvement, commercialization, conservation of indigenous genetics, fish inseminations, and maturation embryo transfer technologies in the country. Doing beef as a business, one, you need to look at the breed of the animal, the system of production, then the available feed resources, then you can start from there. Usually the beef, when we talk of beef, we do consider much of, you know, land. However, you can do what we call the feed rotting, and you have a shed like this one, you confine them, you formulate your ratios, and you do the store feeding and the feed rotting. And a normal environment, when it is well fed, these animals, especially the Boran, Brahman, can be putting something like 800 grams per day. You need to have taken the weight and you need to monitor that from day one, maybe because for business, you may not rear them up to 2 years. You can have them just for 1 year, 1 year and a half, starting from even 6 months. There are systems or categories. Then you feed them accordingly. Now, depending on the breed that one is rearing, it will determine the profitability. One who is doing the Boran and Brahman and the Ramanura, those are good animals that do put actually a lot of flesh. So that meaning they reach the slaughter market at an early age, and the quality of the meat or the carcass can really meet the standard market standards. Now that implies that if I have, when you look at the marketplace of meat, maybe something like 10,000, and this animal, the way they are giving it around 500 kgs. So if you take, there is a way how we calculate the carcass weight. We call it dressing carcass percentage. If you take something like 53 or 55 out of 400 or 500, and you have average like 250, that is carcass weight. Now the carcass weight, meaning that you've slaughtered, there is no skin, you've emptied the rumen, everything. It is now just meat. You're looking at now the meat. Then you get that 250 carcass weight, you multiply by that 10,000, and you're good to go in something like 2.5, 3 million in that range at an RAH. Now, of course, now you can go back and think of all these enterprises and the livestock, they make money, but one need to understand the gestation period indeed. One has to incorporate in something like patient in this. A poultry farmer will earn money at even day one. The goat, at maybe at the age of 1 year or six months, the growers and the kids, he or she can sell and generate money. The one operating pigs or piggery production, at 3 months or 114 days, he or she would have gotten the piglets. Maybe after 1 month, he or she can sell and get money. Those are gestation periods now. The dairy and beef, their gestation period, one, by the time like a diary or this one, by the time they conceive to give birth, that is like at around 24 months, that is when they start giving birth. That means within the period of 2.5 to 3 years, that's when I'm starting to get some money from diary. For these ones, I may not wait to have 3 years because this is a fattening program. I need meat and then I need money. So I can decide. There are those who are doing that, like from weaning to fattening now. There I can sell. Weaning, it can happen after 6 months, you wean, you send those bulls or the beef animals to the fattening program, the feed rods now. They are fed past 1 year, then targeting a certain weight. I may say, for me, my Borans or Brahman or Ramanira, I will sell them when they've attained like maybe 400 kgs live weight, and when they can attain that, maybe when they are 1.5 years, depending on the feeding program you've given them. Remember, they are beef, you can do what we call a drip feeding or a drip bottom, whereby you give them feeds 24/7, targeting a certain weight at a certain period. So it depends, the available sources of feeds, also the system of production, and the breeds, your money, and your program of the project. I can decide even at 1 year, I will be disposing them of. At 2 years still, there is what we call pelleted feeds or concentrates, and there's what we call the cattle nuts. These are good whereby, of course, now for these ones, these are beef, and we are targeting fattening. So that means I'm going to look at my formula, and then I increase the amount of that feed resource that is giving too much fat, that can increase the fat content on them. Then I increase the ration that. If they are in open grazing, that is ranching, then I ensure that I have enough pastures. But it is always advisable, if you're doing it as a business, you can have the feed rod whereby there is no movement, there is no wastage of energy. So everything is put into production and you're feeding them adequately so they are contained. By 6 months, when you're looking at like the Brahman, by 6 months, I mean 6 months, they will be just early weaned, 280 to 300 kgs live body weight. They must have attained that. Then by the time they reach 1 year and a half, then they go up to 400. That is if they are well fed. Yes, the Ramanura the same. This Boran, by that time they can be still 150 to 200 at 6 months. To first weigh it. So the parameters that we take when we're developing the feed ratios, one, we look at the body weight, live body weight. After that, when it is beef, I just need the age and the system now. I only need just the weight. If it is 400, that is live body weight, I can decide to give it, usually they are giving it 3% of its body weight. It's like now Uganda was hit with a lot of dry spells. But these animals, you can look at them, even outside in our farms, they are looking good. They can still come back and pick up. And like some of the exotic, too much exotic, and especially looking at dairy. Then when we look at the crosses, we have the crosses now, the Cemento and Brahman crosses. We're looking at now crossing Brahman, Cemento, Boran with Ankore. Remember, when we are crossing, we're looking at some of the desirable traits to be passed on to the offsprings. So the Brahman is a beef. Our Ankore, it is a typical local animal, an indigenous here. It is resistant and tolerant. The Brahman puts on too much weight. What does that mean? That the Brahman is going to pass over the genetics or that desirable traits of high growth rate, reaching maturity at an early age, onto that offspring. Then also the Ankore will have that contribution now of resistance and tolerance to the environment. We need money. We need to improve livelihood. And when you look at the demand, say like the demand of, you know, meat demand, like export, by the time if they want maybe like a ton of meat from like each and every farmer, and you're rearing a zebu or an ankore, a mature one will weigh around, the ankore will weigh around 400, 450, the mature one. The zebu will be around 300, 350, and that is a good one. The carcass will be less than that. So what does that imply? This one is weighing around 500 when it is at 3 years. It will go up to something like 650 when it goes to four and a half years. That means I may have at least 50% of that carcass weight. That means I can easily at least contribute and generate some good money when I'm having the improved genetics than someone who is in too much rock.
Well, it's popularly said that innovation only stops when you stop thinking. So the more you open up your mind to think about something new, you could actually go ahead and keep reinventing or making something different out of the ordinary. Okay, let's talk personal finance tips for this week. And today we are discussing what savings are and just how much is enough. Now, the question should be, what are the drivers that one can consider to invest, I mean, for saving? And also, if you're saving, is there like a particular amount of money that you should save, or should the amount saved be determined by how much you earn? Well, that is what an expert, Luanga, that is from Standard Chartered Bank, tells us in this conversation with Cynthia. Personal finance tips for this week.
Oscar, we are about to talk about investment and financial literacy, financial freedom, and how people can navigate such difficult times. Thank you so much for accepting to speak to us. And can you please start by introducing yourself?
Thanks again, Cynthia. My name is Oscar Mwanga, and I'm responsible for the fixed income department at Standard Chartered Bank, which broadly covers investments for the bank, but also individuals like myself and yourself into accessing some of these financial instruments.
Okay, so listen, we take some basic things, principles about financial well-being for granted, like savings.
Yeah.
So today I want you to kindly talk to us about how can someone save even during such a crunch. We know things are high and we can easily make that excuse that we don't have anything left to save.
Yeah.
But talk to us about saving, why it is important and how someone can go about it in such difficult times.
Yeah, thank you. Savings can be viewed as delayed gratification. It can be viewed as putting aside money for a rainy day. But I think in all of that, saving serves as a bedrock for financial freedom. Because what it does is you give up consumption today despite the circumstances. And you are right. It is a tough economic environment where prices are significantly higher for some essential commodities, be that fuel, be that food. But I think the crucial component is, however small it is, there is no effort of saving that is wasted. And I think that is the crux of it. And it's quite important to start it early. The earlier you start saving, you will find that the more your savings work for you. Because later on we'll talk about different vehicles of saving, but the earlier you start, the more you have the benefit of time working on your side. And our viewers are a young demographic. Uganda in general is a young demographic. So finding a safe place to put your savings and the right vehicles to service those savings is quite important. But I think the real beginning of it is to have meaningful goals that give you the drive to give up consumption now, for those goals later. And I think that forms the basis of the discipline required to keep going, to keep saving despite the environment. And like you mentioned, while it's a lot more difficult, I think it also goes to show that people who have accumulated savings find such difficult moments, which come and go, which are transitory, they find it a little bit easier to manage those difficult moments. I think a good way to look at it is a very famous children's story about the ant and the grasshopper. When there was a time of plenty, the grasshoppers ate all their harvests, whereas the little ant kept putting a little away. An ant is quite small, and it kept putting a little bit away for that rainy day. It didn't know when that rainy day would come. The amount it was putting away was quite small, relatively speaking. But when winter came, and winter did come, as we see now, the ant was at a much better off place. And the moral of that story was, it's not about the amount you save. It's the act of saving itself that builds upon itself and, you know, fulfills quite a few of our own promises. So
we always hear that one of the principles of saving is that you take away first before you spend, right?
Yeah.
So if people say, I am too broke, I live hand to mouth, and I want you to speak more to about the power of the compounding effect.
Yeah.
What is that, first of all, and how can someone achieve it despite all of it?
So, you know, compounding, and you are right, it's close to, some call it the eighth wonder of the world. Now, compounding is a very important concept in money, you know, or managing your finances over a long time. What it requires to start with is something to be put away. Let's say 1 shilling, right? Compounding works in this way. You get paid interest on money, right? So let's say that 1 shilling earns another shilling. So you have 2 shillings. If you do not eat that additional income, you now have 2 shillings working for you. If you invest it, it earns another shilling. Now you have 3 shillings. So what compounding does over time is that that momentum builds up such a very big snowball that you find that you reach a stage where your savings or your investments are actually generating a lot more income than you might need, or generating income such that you can invest in other projects, or income such that you can fulfill some of your goals that you put forth. But compounding needs time, and I think that is what is crucial here. And the benefit you know, most of the young viewers have is time. If you're 18 years old, you have a long time, 47 years to 65. In terms of money, that is a long time. And a lot of miraculous things can happen to your money if you start those habits now.
Interesting. So what are the options, investment or saving vehicles that are available to anybody who wants to start a journey?
Well, there are quite a number. And I think it varies, you know. I think the way to see how varied the options are is to consider how many different things people do for a living. You could argue that you could invest in anybody, and if they are productive, that could be an investment. But for the purposes of, you know, our viewers and our interview and the broad theme of financial literacy, I'm going to talk about financial investments. Locally, the most easily accessible are center around government bonds. This is something you can access directly. You know, the minimum required is 100,000 to invest in a bond, or you could do this through collective investment schemes, what they're called unit trusts or mutual funds, and there are quite a number, including the Shilingi Fund that was launched by Standard Chartered recently. And what those tools give you access to is these very basic investment vehicles. So how bonds work is that you're effectively lending money to the government, and in turn the government pays you interest every 6 months until that bond matures. Now, we spoke about time horizon. The longer you invest, the higher the interest you earn. The shorter you invest, that amount reduces, and that slope is quite, you know, is quite gradual. But the difference over a long time is quite large. I feel for everybody, the outcome should be, or the goal should be, to stay invested for a long time, because that's where the compounding effects come into play, and you know, your money works longer for you. So the vehicles that we have, fixed income is available here, which are government bonds and government bills. We have a stock exchange which has equities. You can invest in companies that are listed on the stock exchange, and people invest in, some of them, in real estate vehicles, for example, which are not quite active here. But in terms of financial instruments, I would say unit trusts give you access to bonds, quite straightforward, and collective investment schemes as well deliver the same result.
Thank you, Cynthia and Oscar, therefore, the update from Personal Finance Tips. We hope that you have learned one of the possible vehicles that you can put your money on Government bonds kind of sounds like something very big, but it is well paying, so maybe you might have to consider. And that's a lot, as low as 100,000 shillings. You don't need so much money for you to start. So maybe meet someone, just your financial expert, and ask them how this can be done. And that should change how you save your money. If you have issues with saving at home, then you could maybe start on this and see how it could turn up in 6 months. You could be making some money. All right, let's talk to Ali now, and he has the latest from the Forex and stock market, including a recent report, I think, yes, from the Uganda Securities Exchange. Over to you, Ali.
Yes, in the stock market this week, activity at the Uganda Securities Exchange remains robust. Total turnover as at end of October increased to 35.2 billion as compared to only about 16 billion in the same period last year. Now, the increase in turnover is due to payment of dividends by some of the listed companies such as Umeme, MTN, among others. However, stock prices at the Uganda Securities Exchange remain depressed due to government appetite for cash. Some investors are selling off their equities to invest in government securities due to higher returns. Factors such as inflation appear to be taking a toll on investors at the Uganda Securities Exchange. We spoke to Paul Bwiso, the Chief Executive Officer at Uganda Securities Exchange, for more updates on what's happening at the stock. Take a look.
Yes, I'll probably report on end of October, the numbers. So the turnover is at about 35.2 billion. At this particular time last year, turnover was at 16.8 billion. So we are more than 100%. And compared to the full year 2021, turnover was at about 33 billion. So over and above, we're seeing over 100% increment in turnover. What has driven this? Dividend payments on some of their counters, especially say MTN and Umeme. Umeme continues to dominate trading turnover on the exchange, followed by MTN and then Stanbic. So investors have seen that there's opportunity. Prices are depressed, of course, because of the opportunities within the government bond market. I think we've seen interest rates for 3 year, 5 year, 10 year above 15%, and stretching to, I think, the 20 year, that was at about 18.5% a few months back, or about a month back. So the opportunities still arise because we're seeing profitability within the companies. We saw Cipla report a profit and pay a dividend for the first time this year, but also its half-year returns were released, and it's showing remarkable improvement. So as New Vision, Uganda Clays, similar position. So the inkling towards dividend payments has given investors an opportunity to actually return to the market, despite the better returns in the bond market.
Last week, it emerged that government will not be renewing Umeme's concession when it expires in March 2025. And a few things seem to be playing out in the market. For instance, demand for Umeme shares seem to be strong in the market, but those holding shares want people to pay a little more to transfer those shares to them. In the currency market this week, the Uganda shilling opened the week on a stronger footing against the US dollar, opening trading at 3,755 and 3,765 buying and selling respectively, as corporates started remitting mid-month taxes to government. More details on market developments in your copy of The New Vision with me, Ali Toha. See you next week.
So for those driving, looks like the interest is going downwards, and I'm talking about fuel prices. Almost every time you look at a pump now, there is a slight drop, whether it's 100k or 50 shillings, or 50 shillings or 80 shillings, there's suddenly a drop. And this is only good news for those, you know, engaging in business, because the lower the price of fuel, the lower the products that are brought to the market. Somehow you understand how business and fuel works. So if the guys transporting these things are taking fuel at a lower rate, then they will charge the owners of the product something that is slightly lower. Then you, the final person, that the final consumer, will also get the product at a lower rate. Let's run you through how the different cities across the country are faring in terms of fuel prices. Okay, that should do for this week's edition. Thank you so much for joining us. Now, recently, you know, I keep saying, if you want anything, get back or get in touch with us and we'll be more than glad to help you. I recently got a call from one Zahra. Yes, she actually called here and she wanted a contact of someone that did feature on the show. And I tell you what, they're really doing business together. And this is something that you could probably, as a viewer, also pay attention to. If there's something you're doing and you have maybe watched and you think if you, you know, partnered with this person, you could make something happen, why not? We're here and we'll be more than glad to help you get in touch with the person, because we have those contacts anyway. And if it can help your business, you know what, we'll be walking home and saying, yes, I think we've made it. Satisfaction of the client is gift a business person. And that is probably one of the things that stood out at the Global Entrepreneurship Week that was celebrated here in Kampala. Satisfaction of the client, keep in touch with the client, keep reinventing your product, and always ensure that you learn from your competition. Don't hate someone that does the same business as you. Stick around and learn from them what else is new that you can pick up to better your business. My name is Simon, and from me and the rest of the team here, it's thank you for making time. We'll see you soon. Bye-bye.